Welcome back. Alongside Chris Johnson, I am Christopher Harrison. And this is Developing SharePoint Server Core Solutions. So where we left off is we had just set up our first SharePoint hosted app. And maybe it was because, you know, it was my demo. But I thought that was actually pretty cool. You know, nice little way to execute code. Well, now what we want to do is we want to take a look at dealing with a remote hosted or a cloud hosted app.
So as much as I love JavaScript, Christopher, I'm a F5 compile kind of guy. Why don't I take this one, and we'll walk through some of the options for folks that want to look at cloud-hosted solutions.
Okay.
And which include back-end code and all those sorts of goodies.
Okay.
All right.
Awesome.
So what we're going to look at, we're going to do a quick overview of the remote-hosted app options.
Mm-hmm.
Just recap those. And we're going to go and dive into a demo and talk about how you build one up and how you deploy it and how you develop it and so forth. When I say provider-hosted and remote-hosted, those are completely interchangeable. So in the slides, sometimes they're called remote-hosted here. I sometimes slip into calling them provider-hosted, so people will know that if I say one or the other.
Right.
Okay, so first up, we're just going to recap things. Then we're going to take a look at how back-end code in a remote-hosted or provider-hosted app calls back into SharePoint.
Okay.
And some of the authentication mechanisms that are involved in that. Because it's not quite as simple as just making an anonymous call, fire and forget, and everything's hunky-dory. We're going to dive into figuring out and showing folks how apps authenticate back to a SharePoint site.
Right.
And in particular, we're going to talk about provider-hosted apps. Much of the same stuff is applicable for auto-hosted as well, but I'm predominantly going to talk about provider-hosted. And the reason I'm going to do that is it's by far and away the most popular at the moment, and auto-hosted can't be submitted to the store just yet. So it's pretty much the only option for store apps other than SharePoint-hosted, obviously. Okay, so just recapping, you mentioned SharePoint-hosted apps where all the assets are in the SharePoint site.
Mm-hmm.
Auto-hosted, where you've got some code and it gets pushed off into Azure, but Microsoft manage that Azure component for you, that Azure tenant, and you don't have any control over it. And then finally, provider-hosted, where you have to, as a developer or as a independent software vendor, or ISV as they're called, have to provide the back end of the application. And so typically that would be an Azure component, but could be, you know, Heroku or some other system for hosting that if you wanted.
And again, with the pencils.
Exactly.
Yes.
Stabbing yourself in the face with pencils. Love it. All right. So with provider hosted, the other thing to consider is that you have one back end for multiple apps instances. So say you install an app on your SharePoint server. You install my SharePoint, my provider hosted app.
Mm-hmm.
You install it. Somebody else installs it. Somebody else installs it. Only the declarative components are going into their SharePoint environment. All of the back end code and infrastructure is hosted by me. And typically once. So I have to consider things like multi-tenancy in my app to make sure if I'm storing data that I'm partitioning it by tenant or by client and things like that. So these are some of the considerations you have to think about when you're building a provider-hosted app. Okay. Authentication. So in cloud-hosted apps, your code runs remotely. It's not hosted on pages inside of SharePoint. It typically runs in a system, say, such as Azure. You can still use the client-side object model to call into SharePoint. However, there needs to be some sort of security and authentication, an authorization mechanism between those two systems, right? You've got SharePoint, you've got your Azure code, and we've got to make sure that when calls come from Azure, they're only allowed to access the stuff they're allowed to access, and in the context that they're supposed to access it. And by that, what I mean is as a user who's using the app.
Right.
Or just as the app. But there has to be a set of permissions around that. So there's really two types of auth. Internal authentication is for things like code running on SharePoint pages, such as a SharePoint-hosted app. It can call back into the app web, and everything's fine. You don't need to do any additional heavy lifting or wiring up of authentication and so forth for those types of components. External authentication is the piece I'll be talking about mostly, which is around this cloud-hosted or provider-hosted model. And that's when we need to consider things like OAuth, or what we call server-to-server authentication, to facilitate that authentication between those two components.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in Office 365, apps can talk back to SharePoint, and they're authorized through the use of OAuth. If you're not familiar with OAuth, it's a standard used by a number of cloud providers, like Facebook and Twitter and so forth. And in the Office 365 world, most of it's facilitated using Azure ACS, or Access Control Services. And so it's OAuth between our two components.
Right.
So if the app wants to make a call into SharePoint, it needs to deal with some OAuth tokens and basically request access and then make the calls. Now, on-prem, you can still do provider-hosted apps, but you may not have access to Azure Access Control Services to facilitate the OAuth. And so you've got two choices. You can set up what's called server-to-server trust, which is used by some internal components between SharePoint and Exchange, for example, but also can be used between a provider-hosted app and SharePoint. Pardon me. Or there is actually a second option for on-prem, which is kind of a hybrid model where you can set up your SharePoint farm to actually use Azure ACS and then still do OAuth between the two components. That is a much more advanced topic. Both of those, setting up S2S and setting up hybrid OAuth, are much more advanced topics than we have time for today. But if those interest you, there's material up on MSDN and so forth for folks to go and take a read of.
Right.
We're going to be mostly focusing on the OAuth side of the house. So just looking at those in sort of a little more graphical detail, we have the various components of an app. You've got, on the right-hand side of the slide, you can see the remote web. On the left-hand side, you can see the host web. And between the two are the calls using the CSOM. In this case, it's possible on-prem to set up server-to-server trust, which is abbreviated as S2S. And that's basically a certificate-based authorization or authentication system that basically says when a call comes in to SharePoint from the app, it's signed using a certificate and it can validate that it's come from somebody who should be allowed in.
Right, and that's actually something that's relatively common in a lot of Microsoft Server products, that if I do need to be able to communicate from one system to another, it's pretty typical that you have to swap certificates in order to enable that trust. So this is very similar to what you've likely done in other environments.
Exactly, yeah. So that's on-prem.
Mm-hmm.
You can't use that for Office 365. And for Office 365, we use OAuth instead.
Right.
And this is facilitated, like I said, with Access Control Services. And so what happens when an app wants to call SharePoint is it basically calls out to ACS and says, hey, I need an access token, gets an access token, and then uses that to send with its requests back into SharePoint. And so then SharePoint says, hey, is this a valid access token? And it chats with ACS and says, this is valid. And it says, yep, cool. And then it lets the call go ahead. And so that's how the calls are authorized in a very basic sense. Okay, so we've talked a little bit about the theory of on-prem and the theory of the cloud. Let's dive a little deeper into how these things come together. So, configuring remote hosted apps. Now, there are really two or three things that factor into this this area of the topic. One is how you define what permissions apps have.
Mm-hmm.
So you want to say, hey, Mr. App, I want you to be able to get access to the movies list and the movies list only. Or I want you to get access to properties in the web and only properties in the web. And so you have to go through and basically set up and say, hey, here are the permissions that you get access to. And so you do that through the manifest like you do with much else. And there is an IDE over the top of this in Visual Studio that we'll show you in a minute.
Yay!
Nice wizards. But you can also dive into the app manifest.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the app manifest not only says what permissions you have, but it also has some other details in there about your application. And the first one that I'll point out up here is this auto-deployed web application. Now, this signifies that when the app is loaded into SharePoint, that it's an auto-hosted app. That doesn't exist there when it's not a auto-hosted app. That gets replaced. If you're using a provider-hosted app up in Azure, for example, that wouldn't be set just like that. Also, in the web config, you need to put your ID and secret. Now, the ID and secret, so the ID and secret for auto-hosted apps, these are all filled in on the fly by SharePoint. You have no control over what those end up being. They get filled in on the fly. But for provider-hosted apps, this would be where you'd put your OAuth ID and secret. And we'll talk a little bit about the OAuth keys when we get into deploying apps a little later in this session. But that's where they would go in this web.config file. So for provider-hosted apps, it's very similar as well, right? You have to go and basically say what it can get access to. If you're doing S2S, you need to set up certificates and so forth first. You need to register your app, that sort of thing. But the manifest requirements are quite similar. We've got an example of some of the XML showing up here on the screen asking for permissions. So in this case, we're saying app permission request, the write is I want read access, and then the scope says what you want access to. So in this case, my app is saying I'd like read access to the web, which will give us access to information about the web.
Right.
If you want to be able to do write back, you have to switch that to a write access, and in this case, we're saying the scope is equal to list, which means I want write access to lists. You've also got some others that you can see down here, like you've got search, you've got write access to the social microfeed. That's the microfeed that shows up on my sites and so forth. So there are a whole set of these scopes that you can allow access from apps. And so there's a whole list of these up on MSDN for the types of permissions that you might want to request.
And
again, you don't need to know this XML. It's also in the wizard in Visual Studio that we'll take a look at in the demo.
It is. I do want to, once my system comes to life here, just because I went off and grabbed the URL real quickly here, on the screen there, and I'll throw it up into the chat window, that's the URL where you can head to if you're curious about all the different URLs that you can punch in for permissions. Because
Great.
You're going to notice you're not going to explicitly type out, hey, I want this site name or I want this list name, because you have no idea whether or not it's actually going to be in the host. So what you're doing is a bit more generic. Hey, I want permissions to this. Hey, I want permissions to that.
Correct. And you wouldn't want to hard code the site URL anyway. So
exactly.
It's actually worth pointing out, you see how it says SharePoint in this URL? That is not the address of your website.
Exactly.
That always says SharePoint.
Right.
And so when your app gets deployed, this would obviously be referring to the site that it's being added to.
Right.
Cool. All right. So developing remote hosted apps. So we're going to talk a little bit about some of the freedoms you get with building provider hosted apps over previous sort of options you had with building SharePoint solutions.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to talk about the security requirements. We're going to talk about branding the applications using the Chrome control that you mentioned in a previous module.
That's a big one.
I'm going to show adding that to a provider hosted app.
Yep.
Amongst a whole lot of other stuff in the demo. So I'm trying to go through these slides relatively quickly so we've got plenty of time for the demo.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of choosing the technologies, you know, no longer are you bound by what SharePoint's built on. So in the past, it used to be, you know, .NET 3.5 or .NET 3 or 2 or whatever it was at the time,
right.
That particular version. And it was quite frustrating for developers who wanted to do, like, new and cool stuff from Scott Guthrie, for example. And you'd sit there in the tech ed demonstrations.
All the cool stuff
exactly.
Comes from,
Scott,
yes.
Scott Goo's the man. Anyway, so you'd watch these presentations in the keynotes and you'd get totally jazzed about all this new cool stuff that was coming from the developer division when the Goo was over there.
Mm-hmm.
And he was rocking the red shirt and everything was awesome. And then you'd go back to work and you'd be, well, I can't do that in SharePoint.
Yep.
And that was painful. And all the .NET guys would be sitting there like, hee hee, you know, we rule, SharePoint sucks. But now you've got the freedom and opportunity to do the back end of your app in pretty much whatever you like. Obviously, I'm a Microsoft guy. I love building stuff in MVC, web forms, that sort of ASP.NET world.
Mm-hmm.
But like I've said and like we've mentioned a few times, you could do this on non-Microsoft stuff as well.
Right.
Again, you've got to make calls back into SharePoint to get the data back out using the CSOM or REST, and we've covered both of those.
Yep.
Not a lot changes there. A little bit changes around the security, and we'll talk a bit about that when we get to the demo and show how that works. But then also, you know, if you've got assets that go into the app web, then the same stuff that you were showing before applies as well.
Right.
So a provider-hosted app can consist of all of these pieces. It can consist of back-end code, consist of assets that get deployed into the app web, can reach into the host web and put stuff as well. It's kind of like the whole shooting match.
So to a certain extent, you can basically just run your code using the technology that you want, where it needs to be, based on what your solution is, based on what it is that you're trying to accomplish, rather than, like you said before, being forced into, oh, well, I have to do this by using web forms.
Exactly, yeah. So if you're an MVC person, MVC. If you're a web forms person, web forms. If you're a Ruby person, Ruby.
I'm an MVC person.
Yeah, nice. All right, so looking at the security aspect of these provider-hosted apps, so the way it works under the covers, and a lot of this is abstracted from you by Visual Studio and the helper classes that they provide you. So what happens under the covers when you launch, when the user comes along and they click your application, what actually happens in the launch sequence is SharePoint will create what's called a context token. And this is a piece of data that gets passed across the wire to your app when it starts. And that includes some context about the caller and about the app, what tenant it's on, the site and so forth, whole bunch of information. And also, like you pointed out in one of the previous modules, there are some GET parameters on the URL, such as the SP host URL and so forth.
One of the terms that you snuck in there real quick, and it's something that we've mentioned a couple of times here, and there's a couple of questions about it as well, so it's definitely worth highlighting here, is that word tenant. Because this is something for people who've been working really with on-prem deployments as opposed to working with SharePoint Online, they might not be overly familiar with the concept of tenant, because essentially it was just your web application that wound up being your tenant. And what a tenant is To really kind of oversimplify things, is it's your web app or it's the customer inside of Office 365. So if I go in to an on-prem SharePoint solution, I create a web app, that now becomes my tenant. And so if you're talking about the permission or if you're talking about just tenant in general for on-prem, typically it's going to be the web application. Now the reason I say typically is because SharePoint does support tenancy, which is what allows for things like O365 to exist. So it's technically possible to, in your own local environment, set up tenancy. So if I do need a greater separation between our different departments or otherwise that we're giving access to SharePoint to, we do have the ability to do that. You wind up losing a lot of UI capabilities if you decide that you want to implement that, but it is there. The bigger place is in Office 365 where you see this, that when you set up an Office 365 account and you get what looks to you to be a lot like a web application, what you're actually getting is a tenancy that is being hosted now inside of Office 365. So when we say the word tenant, that's what we're talking about. It's essentially it's the web app in an on-prem solution, or it's your site that you set up inside of O365.
Yeah, if you think about a block of condos or flats or an apartment building, it's kind of like the number on the front of your door.
There you go.
Right. Yep. Each tenant of that building has a different number.
Yep.
So what happens is when you launch the app, SharePoint creates a context token and fires it across to your app, and that contains this information. That in and of itself is not quite enough to call back to SharePoint. What you need to do is use your context token to go and request an access token that you can then use to call back into SharePoint. Now, the Visual Studio helper classes help you with all of this stuff, right? So you'll notice when you create a new application in Visual Studio, a provider-hosted app template provides what's called tokenhelper.cs. And in the Visual Studio 2013 tools, there's also another one called the SharePoint context that we'll talk about in a second as well, which makes things even easier. So you use the context token to get yourself an access token. You use the access token to go call into SharePoint using the CSOM. Each of these tokens have expiries, so the context token can be cached. I believe the out-of-the-box expiry time is about 12 hours for Office 365. Access tokens, I believe, are much shorter, on the order of a few hours. But what happens is...
12.
12 hours for an access token?
Yes.
Okay, that's a decent period of time. And then if you need more of them, you can use what's passed in the context token called a refresh token, which allows you to call back and get a new access token. Now, the refresh token, I believe, is 6 months.
Yes.
So you can cache that in a database, for example, and then you don't need user interaction to use your app. Your app in the background can grab the refresh token, use it to get a new access token, and call back into SharePoint. So that's great for the equivalent of things like timer jobs, right? You could fire off a process in Azure that calls back into SharePoint without user interaction, kind of like a timer job. So those are the three main types of tokens, and we'll take a look at them in the demo, how it all happens. Now, in terms of branding your app, you don't want it to be a real jarring experience usually. So out of the box, there is some JavaScript you can add to your page that reaches back into the host SharePoint site and pulls down some CSS and so forth that allow you to put what's called the Chrome control on the page. And that means that you can use the styles and so forth from that style sheet to brand your app and make it look similar to the host web that you added your app to. And so this, you know, it's not the be-all and end-all of branding, but it certainly helps you start that process.
Right, because again, whenever you're doing SharePoint development in general, the whole goal is always to make it look like it's been there the whole time. You know, people will frequently ask when you're doing web parts, you know, why use properties? Why, you know, use that little thing off to the side? Why not just simply build the UI and just put that straight into the web part? Well, the biggest reason, there's a lot of other reasons, but the biggest reason is because you want this to look like it's been in SharePoint. Like when you installed it, just came right out of the box. The exact same thing holds true with your apps, that you want this to be to look, smell, taste, and feel like it's been there the whole time.
Yeah, absolutely. You don't want that to be, you know, in SharePoint for a period of time, then the user clicks on the app and boom, you're suddenly in some completely different looking environment that doesn't make sense to them or doesn't feel as part of the experience.
Right.
Okay, so rather than talking about that, let's go take a look at building a provider-hosted app. All right, so let me jump out of PowerPoint here for a moment.
There we go.
Doing demos in PowerPoint doesn't always work that well. Let me let my screen come back here. Flip over to my demo box. Okay. All right, so what I've got here is the newly minted Visual Studio 2013 Ultimate.
Ooh.
Fresh off the press. For those with MSDN subscriptions, you can go grab this right now and give yourself a little bit of download time while it comes down.
Well, yeah. We'll finish watching this. You know, you don't want to take up the bandwidth first.
Absolutely. Yeah. Leave the tubes free for us.
Yes.
Okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to say create new project. Now, over on the left-hand side on the templates, you see office/SharePoint and under it apps. So I want to create an app for SharePoint, much like you did with a SharePoint hosted app previously. And simply click OK. Now, these are baked into Visual Studio 2013.
Mm-hmm.
Out of the box, you get to tick them or untick them as part of your install experience. For 2012, go add them. You can go and get the tools pack that adds all this stuff. The templates and so forth in 2013 changed a little bit as well, and I'll try to point out those differences along the way. So we've got our wizard. We get the same choices down in the bottom here that you said previously. I want to pick provider hosted. Also, I'll be doing all my demos against my Office 365 site. So my box, SharePoint free.
Okay. Right?
It's only got Visual Studio on the box.
Nothing up your sleeves except for your arms.
Nothing up my sleeves. I've got a browser, Visual Studio, and Fiddler. And that's it.
Because really, you got to have Fiddler.
Absolutely. Fiddler, first best developer tool on the planet. Okay. So as you can see, I've got SharePoint.com. This is my SharePoint Online site, and I've got my developer site collection created under there. I click Next. Then you get a choice. Do you want this to be a web forms app or a MVC app? I'm going to pick MVC because I want to show folks through. I noticed in the chat that we had a few folks asking about whether MVC was supported in the templates, so we'll show that.
Nice.
I can click Next. Now, the next choice is whether... Effectively, it comes down to two things. Is this going to be used on-prem, in which case you need to configure what's called high-trust apps, or is that server-to-server or S2S authentication? So again, some naming differences here, but high-trust equals S2S equals server-to-server. But for Office 365, I obviously want to use ACS to do my OAuth, OAuth pieces. So I'm going to leave that selected and simply click Finish. Now what's going to happen here is it's going to go create my project, set it all up for me. Elevator music.
And we're waiting.
Thanks, Lana.
So, you know, I always wish instead of it, you know, being the green bar that kept going side to side, maybe if it'd be red, kind of go back and forth. Maybe
wouldn't
have a voiceover
cool?
from one of the doctors
Knight
from
Rider.
St. Elsewhere. Yeah. There you go.
I'm sorry, Michael. All right. Come on.
Your ASP.NET application, it consists of...
Yes.
So congratulations, you've created the project. Well,
yeah.
Not yet.
So we've got an empty project, pretty much. But what it does by default... Goodness knows what it's doing off in the background here. Let me talk through the project structure because we can see that down the right-hand side while it's finishing its work.
Yes.
Let me zoom it here. I'll zoom into the solution structure and just point a couple of things out. So we've got our solution. Again, we've got two projects this time. So the first project is the SharePoint project. And that's going to contain anything that's declarative, like the XML, lists, list templates, all that sort of stuff. Then we've got this web project, and this is pretty much a vanilla web project, MVC web project. It's got a whole bunch of stuff in there that's been pre-populated for me, scripts file full of goodness, and it's got a default view and controller and things like that. Let's jump back out. Great. My app finished completing. Some things to point out here. If I go into the properties, if I hit F4 and dive into the properties for my SharePoint app, you'll notice a couple of things. It's going to try and connect with Office 365. And so what it's doing here is getting ready so that when you hit F5, it's going to be able to deploy this straight up to Office 365. So while I'm not ambidextrous, I'll have to type and try to talk.
Or amphibious.
See what I said about not being able to type and talk? I'm completely useless at this. Okay, so let me dive in there. Okay, now the reason it did that was because I specified my SharePoint Online site in the site URL, which was pulled through from the wizard. So if you want to, when you hit F5, it's going to try and talk to that site. That's why it prompted me, because it needed my credentials for Office 365. So if you want to change where it's going to send it to, that's the place to go do it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we've got our two projects. You can see our scripts files full of jQuery goodness, modernizer, bootstrap, all that sort of stuff. That's going to be great. If we take a look at the controller that's provided for us out of the box, it's basically got one action on it called index, which is going to be the default action that happens here. And by default, we get some boilerplate code that I want to walk people through just to show them what's going on here. And I'm going to zoom into this a little bit more so that folks can see what's happening here. So the first thing to point out is that we need a SharePoint context. So this is basically establishing, you know, getting the context for these calls. What site is it coming from? And
mm-hmm.
all of those kinds of things. Similar to figuring out, you know, what site the app was installed on. Then we want to go and get a client context, which we need to make CSOM calls with. So we're going to use that SharePoint context, and we're going to call create user client context for SharePoint host. Now what that's going to do is pass us a CSOM client context object for the host site. So you'll notice here it says SP host.
Yep.
That means we're going to get a client context for the host site, not the app site.
Okay.
So there is another call on this helper library called for app host, or sorry, for SP app web, I think it is.
Yep.
Which would get you the client context for that. Now, now we've got a client context object, we can go and do stuff with it. So we're going to say get the current user for this web, and we want to load some properties about that user. So we're going to say go get the title. Then we're going to make the execute query call, so that the CSOM is going to reach back into SharePoint and make that call. And then when it's done, we're going to stuff the user's title, which in this case will be our name, into the view bag, into a property called username. And so that's going to basically print the username on the default view for this for this page.
One real quick thing that's worth mentioning for those of you who haven't done MVC, and by the way, yes, shameless plug, I was here to record with John Galloway, the MVC Jumpstart. But what you've got is a separation. You've got your controller, which is what Chris is looking for and looking through, and you've got the view, and those are in two separate spheres. I don't want to say really environments, but they're in two separate spots. And so in order to pass data back and forth between the two environments, we can do this in one of a handful of different ways. Mm-hmm. The simplest way to do that is with the view bag, that you just simply toss something inside of there and basically just kind of toss that up over the wall, so to speak, and that will then be accessible from inside the view.
Yeah, for more complex scenarios, you'd want to use a model or something like
exactly,
that.
Exactly, yeah, you'd want to build up an actual object there.
Okay, so that's the rough flow of this code. Now, before we move on, people are probably thinking, cool, I don't see much security stuff in that code. And the reason you don't see much security stuff in that code is because the new templates in Visual Studio 2013 mm-hmm. provide a bunch of help. And if we zoom down into the project structure, down the bottom here, you see two classes, the SharePoint context.cs file and the token helper.cs file. So that SharePoint context file, that contains a class, which funnily enough is called SharePoint context.
Weird.
And it provides us with these, with these, with this context that we're getting from our request. And so it basically looks at the incoming context token from SharePoint, mm-hmm. and it looks at all the GET parameters that have been passed on the URL, and it uses those to go and request a access token for you from ACS.
Right.
It also, and probably even more importantly, caches all that stuff for you by default. So when your context token comes in as part of launching an app, that mm-hmm. only happens once. And so when you switch pages or you change pages, you need to cache that context because you don't have it the second page around. And so the SharePoint context object will help you cache that stuff for you. And by default, it does it in session state. Mm-hmm. But as you can see, the code's included in the template, and you can dive in there and stick it wherever you like, whether that be in a database or whether that be in, you know, Azure, in the Azure cache, for example.
Right.
Anywhere you like. And you can extend that code and tweak around with it as much as you want. Mm-hmm. Previously, you had to do a lot of this yourself. So if you were if you're using Visual Studio 2012, you're going to have to deal with the caching yourself. You're going to have to do all that sort of boilerplate stuff that is out of the box with the Visual Studio 2013 templates. Now, the last thing I want to do before we hit a five on this is just talk a little bit about this attribute on the action. Whoa, there we go. SharePoint context filter. Now, what this is this, this is provided by the new templates in the SharePoint context.cs and token helper file. And this basically signifies, hey, if this action gets called, and it's not, and I don't have a SharePoint context, mm-hmm. I need one.
Right.
And so this can happen a couple of ways. When you're launching the app, a SharePoint context is passed. The SharePoint context helper will cache it for you and establish a context. The second page request, that context is not going to be passed. And so this attribute says, hey, I need a context for this call. So it goes and looks in session for that context. And if it doesn't find it and one is not passed as part of the post to the app, then it will basically redirect the user back to SharePoint and launch the app again and back to this action and pass a new context for you. Again, you had to deal with all of this stuff previously. Now the new boilerplate code will help you with all of that.
Right.
And it deals with expiries of tokens too. So when your context token expires or your access token expires, or your refresh token expires, it will automatically in the background do all the work with ACS to go get that stuff renewed for you.
And if I can just real quick from the MVC side of things, just mention that what that is, and you'll notice it's in the name there, it's a filter, and that's used very commonly throughout MVC to restrict who or how or when or otherwise a particular action is going to be called. So for example, there's an authorize filter, which would mean that you'd have to be authorized, or you could set up a role on that, so you'd have to be a member of administrators to be able to access that.
Right.
So that's, you know, again, sort of typical MVC, but specific to our SharePoint app in this case.
Yeah, and this is way easier than it was.
Much easier.
Much easier than
much
it
easier.
Was.
Yep.
Okay, so I'm not going to change any code before we hit F5 here. I'm just going to hit F5 and show you what the out-of-the-box experience is like.
Cool.
I'm also going to use Fiddler to show folks what things look like behind the scenes, what happens when an app gets launched. So to do that, I'm going to snap Visual Studio to the right-hand side.
Windows 7 was my idea.
I am going to snap Fiddler. If you haven't got Fiddler, fiddler2.com, I believe, is the URL. Eric Lawrence's tool, fantastic. And it basically shows us all the interactions between my machine and Office 365. So let's hit start and see what happens. So I'm building my app. Build in progress, deploy started, installing app for SharePoint. If the demo gods are with me, everything will go smoothly and we should launch the app. And so what's going to happen here is the browser is going to launch and it's going to start trying to launch my app. It's asking me to log in to Office 365, so I'll do that. Then what we're going to see, I haven't started Fiddler, which is why you can't see transactions happening yet, because I wanted to show what happens when you're installing the app. So part of the installation of an app is trusting that app and telling it, hey, this is cool. It needs access to these things. So in our case, it needs basic access about the site, so read access, and I want to get access to some user information.
Mm-hmm.
Again, this goes back to those permission demands that were made in the app manifest. If I'd done write access, you'd start seeing things pop up here as well.
Right. If I can say just real quick, one of the big things about trusting an app is that it's an all or nothing proposition. That if the app says, I want to do this, 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 and this, you don't have the ability to say, well, I want you to be able to do that and that, but nothing else.
Yeah.
The other thing that's worth highlighting is remember that apps are designed to be deployed out by users. You're not allowed to deploy out an app that's asking for permissions that you don't have.
Correct. Correct. So that's really important.
Yeah.
The other point I'd make about the app permissions is, although you can define permissions in the app manifest itself and through the UI that I'll show you in a moment, you can also an app can also ask for permissions on demand.
Right.
So it can say, hey, I need access to do a particular thing, wasn't defined in the app manifest. The user will be redirected back through this same screen to say, hey, do you want to let it get access? Yep. And then it's got renewed access. The app has renewed access to that stuff.
Right.
So when I click trust it, it's going to launch the app. It's going to finish installing it and it's going to launch it. And so we'll see what the app looks like just straight out of the box. And then I'm going to start Fiddler and we're going to launch it again and see what happens behind the scenes. Working on it.
Get right on that, Rose.
Now at this point, when I've deployed it, my app code is the F5 debugging experience with Visual Studio is the app is still running on my box. SharePoint's not. It's deployed the app pieces to SharePoint Online, but it's running all the behind the scenes code and stuff on my local host. Okay, so my name came from the username that came from CSOM. It's been written into the view via the way of the view bag and rendered out on the page. So let's see what happens a little bit behind the scenes. Let's go back to my site. If I go to the homepage here and let me snap IE to the right here, like that. Here's my developer site. It's got a whole lot of apps that I've already added to my site. Let me start Fiddler and we'll show what happens when I click SharePoint App 3. Okay, so it's launched my app. Doesn't seem to have picked up my code off in Fiddler for some reason. Let's see here. What do we got? What have I missed?
You've got a lot of stream calls to the events page.
Yeah, I'm just wondering. So that's for the chat that's going on.
Right.
It's gone into my SharePoint tenant. That's okay too. Oh, I wonder if it's because of this. Let's try this again. Because of HTTPS that everything happens over.
That would do it.
Let's try that one more time and see if this is going to fix it. Let me fire up Fiddler, snap it left. launch my app, capture traffic. Oh, I did it fast enough, did I? Yes. Oh, this is getting messy. No. Okay. My demo gremlins have thwarted me on showing you the traffic in Fiddler. Let me explain what happens in the background instead
sure.
of showing in Fiddler.
Yep.
So as part of the launch process, when you click on the app, it's really a two-step process. What happens is you'll see in Fiddler a direction to appredirect.aspx,
mm-hmm.
and that's the page that constructs and gets the context token for you. What happens in that page is gets all of that information, creates a context token, writes it out to a hidden form on the page,
yep.
and then there's some JavaScript behind the scenes that fires a submission of that form. Now, the reason it does it that way is because it needs to post the SharePoint context to the to your app running behind the scenes. And so it passes it as a post parameter, not as a get parameter. So that's why it needs to do it through a form and submit it on your behalf. And then it gets posted, sent over to your SharePoint app,
mm-hmm.
and the context can be created and the access token can be grabbed and away you go.
Awesome.
So let's jump back to code. So that was a pretty boring default view, right?
Yes.
We want to make this look a little better. So let's go and look at the view for this. So it's on the home controller, index. Let's open that guy up. Now what I want to do is go and add some additional JavaScript to the Chrome control.
Okay.
Actually, I need to do this in the main piece of the view, not the inner the piece that the home controller adds.
Yeah. So a real quick MVC thing. What he's opened up is the layout, which is in web forms terms the master page, if you will. That all of that is going to surround the outside of every single page that you create. That this is basically going to be the Jell-O mold, if you will, for all of your pages. It's going to define the structure. And so for a lot of the different JavaScript calls that you're going to be making, that will be global to all pages or maybe almost all pages. Those should be in some way, shape, or form referenced inside of that that layout page.
Right. So what we want to do is effectively go and replace the navbar of our out-of-the-box MVC app.
Mm-hmm.
So up in the default view here, as you see this navbar div, let's go and get rid of that. So from the view, we don't want that navbar at the top. It's a black bar up the top. And what we want to do is go in and add some additional things down in here.
And while you're adding some additional things, very technical way to put that, the one little thing that I want to mention is this is using a little thing called Bootstrap, which was developed by Twitter. And the whole goal of Bootstrap is to make it easier to create sites that, kind of look, smell, taste, and feel very similar, kind of that modern web experience, and then also scaling down as needed. So if you are going to be looking at that with a smaller device, say a Surface, or a phone or otherwise, that it's going to scale down properly for that. Bootstrap has just become increasingly popular, built now into Visual Studio 2013. And I'd actually go one step further to say that you're probably noticing this almost everywhere, that if you do any browsing on your mobile phone, if I was to venture, I guess it seems anyway that like half the sites that I go to are all based on Bootstrap.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, it's a great toolkit, right?
It
now
is.
We can leverage it in SharePoint apps. Fantastic.
Yeah. Yep.
Okay, so what I pasted down the bottom here was a script block. And what this is going to do is when the document is ready, I should change my demo now I know the shorthand
yeah.
for it.
Yeah, see?
When the document is ready, it's going to do a couple of things. First, it's going to get the URI
yep.
to the SharePoint host and the app web URL.
Yep.
Then it's going to go, sorry, go ahead.
Oh, well, I was going to inject real quick. If you remember back to the earlier demo, we highlighted the URL. Those are being passed in as query string parameters. That's where those are coming from. So that SP host URL, that SP app web URL, all of that is coming from the parameters that are passed in a part of the query string.
Right. So I've added the JavaScript in here. It's going mm-hmm. to go grab the URLs. Then it's going to get this script base. So underscore layouts / 15 /, that's going to be the root of where we need to make a couple of calls to.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason we need to do that is because we need to go get the CSS from that remote site. And so that's what we're doing here. We're basically saying I want to create a new link element and add it to the document. I want to add a style sheet, and I want to go and get it from this location. So it'll be /_layouts WAC15 WAC default CSS dot ASHX.
Yep.
And that's going to spit out the CSS for this. Then I'm going to go grab the head element of the document and go and append the link to that CSS, so it's going to add it to our page. Now, what I'm actually going to do is I'm going to flip to a slightly different solution here. Let me just close this out, because I've got a pre-baked one that I want to make sure that it all goes super snazzy and that people get a good experience.
So while you're doing that, one of the questions that came up earlier was about claims-based authentication and Kerberos and things like that. One of the big things about using apps is that this is built on top of claims-based authentication. You actually have to have claims-based authentication on any app that's going to be hosting or any web application that's going to be hosting a SharePoint app. The reason for that is that the way that the tokens work is built on top of that claims-based authentication, because I'm going to send down, essentially, typically, two tokens. And this can vary a little bit depending on where you are, what it is that you're doing. But typically, it's going to be two tokens. It's going to be one token for the user, and then it's going to be one token for the app.
Right.
And it's going to be those two items that will then be used to figure out whether or not you can perform the operation that you're trying to perform.
Exactly, yeah. So let's go take a look at that that same layout file, just so I can show you exactly what's going on here. So there's our JavaScript. Here is the getQueryString parameter, function. That just allows us to pull the query string to bits. And then, now the important part down here is renderChrome function. So this is actually what sticks the Chrome control on the page. Mm-hmm. So we've got the CSS loaded. We just added a control that does that.
Yep.
Now we need to get the Chrome on the page.
Yep.
And so the renderChrome function does that. What it does is it creates this object, and it provides parameters about how you want the Chrome control to render. It says, where's your icon that you want to show? What's the title of the app that you want to show? Then you get to say things like, what's the help URL that you want it to point at?
Mm-hmm.
And the settings link is a menu over on the right-hand side that you get to populate with items. Then it's going to say, go and stick this navigation on this placeholder div. And so what I've done is up the top here, you can see where the navbar was. I've added this div, Chrome control placeholder div. So that's where it's going to put the new nav control.
Perfect.
And then finally, if I just mouse back down, sorry about the scrolling. Is it's going to say nav.setVisible is true. And so that's going to actually add it to, add it and make it visible to the page.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let's try run this. Let's click start. Okay, we're going to get our browser. Not sure why I'm getting SSL problems. I think it's probably because I was fiddling around and fiddler with SSL and I haven't closed it. So let me close that.
It's a lovely shade of red.
Not bad, huh? Working on it. My app is starting. Here we go. And so now you've seen the page load, right?
Yep.
And you saw it sort of snap. And the reason it snaps is because first it's dynamically loading the CSS, then when the document's ready, it's running that Chrome control script and adding it to the page. And so here you can see the setting I set for my app. It's got the icon on the right, on the left, and on the right it's got those menus that I added in the JavaScript.
Right.
It also by default puts a link up in the top left called Back to Site, and if you click that, that'll take you back to your SharePoint site where the app is installed.
One of the things that's worth highlighting about that is because of the fact that we're doing that immersive experience where we're just dropping you into that page and making it separate from SharePoint, it's a little bit jarring as it is for the user, but at some point they're going to want to be able to get back to the site from whence they came, get back to where they once belonged. And so the challenge is making sure they can easily get back to that. So you will need to add in that link. And I would go one step further to say that if you are going to be doing any form of marketplace development, that link is required to be there.
Right, right. So in this example, I've actually added the name of the site where the app was installed,
yep.
called developer site, as well as my username. So you can see those both coming through on the view.
Mm-hmm.
Now here's a quick tip, trick, and funny joke. So if I stop this, it's actually not a funny joke at all. It's a quick tip though. See this commented out line? Set bottom header visible is false. Let's just run that again. I get asked this quite a bit. How do I get rid of that goop at the top? I just want the blue bar. I don't want the icon or the title at the top.
Mm-hmm.
So if you add that JavaScript function call in, when your app loads, it'll get rid of that stuff from the top. And that's kind of a little handy tip there. That call, as far as I can tell, is not documented in MSDN.
Oh.
But I found it. There you go. So it doesn't have the bit at the top.
Oh, there you go.
Make it nice and simple. So let's dive back into the app quickly and take a look at how we would configure it for various permissions and so forth. So if we dive into the SharePoint app and double-click App Manifest, we get a nice designer that we get to play with. If you go on here and you hit F7 or right-click and say View Code, you'll get the regular old XML. In here, a couple of interesting things. They also surface in the designer. So you can give your app a title, you know, a name, you get a version number, you get to point it at the app icon that you want to use.
Mm-hmm.
The start page is interesting. This basically says where in your provider-hosted web should I go to when somebody clicks your app to start it.
Right.
Right? And then what you want to pass on the query string. And so by default, we've got this little token here called standard tokens, which is basically, SharePoint will fill that out with a whole bunch of standard tokens that get passed, like SP site host, that sort of thing. And then finally, the hosting type, provider hosted.
Yep.
Also, if I flip over to the permissions tab, this is where I can come in and set permissions. So I can come in and say, my app wants list write access. And again, that's building all the XML behind the scenes, and we're all set. We've got the scopes and things being added to the code. Excellent. So that's kind of a basic provider-hosted app.
Yeah.